Brother Nino, brother, we want you, we want to say thank you for your leadership. We know that you've been leading not only a great church, Calvary City Church, but a great district, Florida Multicultural District.
Yes.
And so we're honored that you would share this with us.
Thank you, Dennis. Thank you very much. I really, really appreciate this opportunity. And I'm grateful. I'm grateful for this, the fellowship, and especially with the Hispanic superintendents, especially the last 2 months, at least, you know, having these meetings every week really has really blessed me. And at least I could have some information of what's going on around the country. So thank you, Dennis, and thank you for your leadership also. And now that Ellie is also part of that team and general counsel, Ellie, thank you very much for your leadership also. Let me preamble this presentation. I started this like 3 years ago, so some of the data has changed since I started. This was a concern of mine, especially, you know, all of you, me and all of you. Every year when the new applicants were coming to the office and the interview, more and more I was noticing that that the age range was getting older. You know, the new ones were getting old. And I'm saying, man, but where are our young people? You know, I mean, you know, God calls everybody. God called Moses and called Abraham and all of that. But when you do a soft research on the actual leaders that are heading the general council, most of them started when they were in their 20s and probably, you know, late 20s and early 30s. But that's not the trend right now. So I said, what's going on? So I decided to look at this more seriously and began to do the research. So the numbers that I will give you and the facts that I will give you, they don't represent the Latinos district. They only represent the FMD. About 3 years ago, I spoke to Byron Klaus, and he helped me in connecting with a program in Oxford, and that they were interested also in topics like this. So long story short is that I decided if I was going to do this research, why not just go all the way and see if this has potential for a PhD. And I told my wife, I know that at my age to begin studying right now, it's not easy, but if two things can happen here, you know, either I get the degree or I scare Alzheimer's disease. So one of the two, I'll benefit from one of the two. So I decided to the study of attitudes of young Latinos and Latinas regarding credentials, Florida Multicultural Assemblies of God. You can skip this. I included this so that you all know the methodology that I was using. I'm using a methodology. It's a qualitative study to understand the proposing. The stories have to be heard. That's what makes this kind of study a qualitative. You have to go to the field and you have to use semi-structured interviews. I allow questions to be adopted. When I started, I have interviewed so far about 25 credential young Latinos. This is the number so far, because after you interview, you have to transcribe, and then after you transcribe, you have to analyze the data, and when you add 25 30-minute interviews, you have a lot of transcriptions. So some of them were face-to-face, other were Skype or FaceTime, but the conversations went from 20 to 40 minutes. So these are pictures of some of our youth event, some of our district and camps event. I just included that just for context. This was my first cohort 3 years ago. I took about 12 guys from our young people from our district, and I began with them. I brought them to the office and I said, listen, I need to hear your heart out. I need to know where you all stand when it comes to ministry, credentialing, the whole thing. So it was an open meeting, not struck at all. I just let them speak, and because I wanted to feel their hearts. So that's how I started about three years ago. These are facts right now. This is what AG has. If you go to AG.org, they have all of your district numbers, all of them. And it sometimes is a little cumbersome, you know, to look at all those numbers, et cetera. But the general council, the last official numbers that they have is 2017. The average age of the general council ordained minister is 60, and the licensed are 50, and the certified are 48. Now, compared to FMD, these are the numbers that we have. We're not too far from the general average, 59, 56, 47. And I could stop right there and ask all of you and ask myself, what does it mean in our district when a minister begins their ministerial, you know, career at 47 years old? You know, what would it mean to the section? What would it mean to the district? What would it mean, you know, to pastoring future vacant churches? So those are questions, you know, just looking at this number, you know, we have ministers starting their ministerial career at 47, which is fine. Like I said, biblically speaking, you know, God uses the 100-year-old, et cetera. I'm not trying to debate theologically here. I'm just looking at these numbers from the ecclesiast perspective, not theological or biblical perspective. There are at least 10,000 Latinos under 40 in our district, that's including adherents and members. Approximately, and the reason why there are 60, only 60 of this entire population that we have in our district, of this pool of 10,000 under 40 people that we have, we only have 60 that decided to pursue a credential, which is like less than 1%, it's 0.006%. FMD right now has 540 credential ministers. So the average AG, these are numbers that you can search right now. The average under 40 in the general council is 21%. We are 11%. So we're under the national average of under 40 ministers. This is FMD. You know your numbers, but we are really below the national average. This small number of credential holders within this age range could be revealing a trend among young Latinos regarding their attitude towards church leadership and its practices, such as pursuing ordination. So this is like my assumption. Okay, every research has to have at least an assumption or a hypothesis. So I'm thinking these numbers are telling us something when it comes to either calling or pursuing further ordination process. This was my question then. You know, I needed my scholars to help me out. So I'm focusing because these research, you know, yes, you can't be too wide and, you know, look at everything, and I can't be looking at the 14 districts or whatever I started. So this is the question: how to influence decision making among young Latinos to become credential ministers? That's what I'm trying to research. How do attitudes affect their decision? So I'm studying right now that aspect. Questions relating attitudes, define leadership. What is the significance of holding credentials with a denomination? What motivated you to receive a credential? You see a connection between local leadership and holding credentials. How active were you before your decision to involve in a credential process. This is my theoretical framework. It's practical theology next. So this research has to do with ecclesiology, practical theology. The theological framework also deals with social reality. These are some numbers that might be changing right now. I'm pretty sure that it has approximately 16 million Latinos. This is not counted, documented Latinos. 55% Catholic, 22% Protestant, 23%. Some of the young Latino challenges is identity, language, immigration issues in the U.S., economic pressures, some not being able to enroll in universities. I use this model. I'm not going to get into a whole lot of the. I use this model to study my issue. I use those because if I'm asking, what's the attitude? What's happening with our young Latinos? That right there, once you ask that question, you're talking social psychology. You're talking attitude. You're talking behavior. So that brings you into the social psychology field. So the model that I use is a model that was proposed by these two gentlemen. One was Isaac Asgen and Martin. How do you study behavior? So they came up with a theory of planned behavior, which is it says this: the immediate predictor of an individual's behavior is their intention. So, you know, is there the intention to become a credential minister? Do our young people have intentions to become? So an intent determined by two factors, attitude and subjective norms. Attitudes are an overall evaluation of an object that is based on cognitive, affective, and behavioral information. So we'll get into that later on. Explaining the model, the individual attitude towards the behavior, whether the person thinks good or is it good to have a credential? Is it bad to have a credential? Subjective norms mean the perceived social pressure to perform or not to perform the behavior. Are they under pressure by their peers to become a minister? Those are factors that need to be looked at. Applying the model means this on the cognitive side. What information, what belief, what thoughts, what attributes do young Latinos have on credentials? That's what we have to look at. What's their opinion on credential? The effective side is how young Latinos feel about having a credential. And then what present or past experience they have encountered with credential. Is it a good experience? Did they experience something negative with a former minister, with a former executive? You know, those are questions. So because these three aspects, cognitive, affective, and behavior, those are the three of an attitude. So if a young Latino has a positive attitude towards a credential, it has to line up positive aspects on these three areas. The proper information, they know what it means, they know the process, they know it well, and they feel good about having a credential. And at the same time, their behavior or past experience has been positive of people that they know that have cognitive side. So these are some of the answers. If you see a YL11 and if it's F or M, is because it's the number that I gave the people that I interviewed so that I could, you know, reserve their names and not be, you know, calling out by name. One person, I call them YL1. If it's a female, I call them YL1F or YL1M. So these are some of the answers that I got from the first part of an attitude, which is information, belief, attribution. So definition of a leader, a person of influence, recognized by superiors, explains objectives, and shows how you get there. A person who stands on the word of God. So these are the definitions that some of these young people have of what is a leader. The importance of being informed. Young Latinos with the proper information can help in the decision-making towards credential. Some of them said, well, we don't have enough information. You know, in our case, they say the information here in the district, we don't know. We go to conventions, but nobody speaks on credentialing. It's not posted, you know, in the proper places where young people are navigating. So this answers, we have lack of information on the Assemblies of God. We don't need some of these young people told me, in our church, we don't even promote Assemblies of God. We got our own thing. The process of communication, ignorance to process of credentials for candidacy. Some of them said pastors can help in encouraging young Latinos towards credentialing. So this has to do with the first, the side. How much information do they have to make a decision towards becoming a credential minister? Connectivity between church leadership and credentials. Someone in the local church invested in me. Others immersed in local church ministry early in their lives. Some of them were in ministry since they were like 14, involved in worship, involved in youth leadership, et cetera, et cetera. Remember, I'm interviewing. These are answers. These are the answers of our 60 credential ministers. Interviewing non-credentials. I'm asking why you 60 are credential. What made you make that decision? So that's the focus of my research. I'm researching 10,000 young people. I'm not researching 100 or 200 young people. I'm asking the question to these. So all these answers are answers that came from the 60 that are credential in our FMD district. So connectivity between church leadership and credential. Someone in the local church invested in me, one said. I was immersed in local church ministry early in my life. Local church ministry serves as a stepping stone that prepares you. I had an understanding of ministry. So these are answers when it came to connectivity. That was the cognitive. Now the affective side of attitude refers to the feelings or emotions linked to the to an attitude object. So I'm going to be focusing on the sense of significance, the sense of being called, being motivated, and the detractors. The sense of significance. So these are some, how significant is having a credential? So see, this is some of the answers of our 60. Of course, I only interview 25, okay? Out of my 60, I have only interviewed, I'm way to at least my supervisor, I should at least interview 40 of my 60s, but I'm on my way. But these are some of the answers. When it comes to having a credential, it gives you standing within the community. It gives you standards and guidelines. It emphasizes the quality of the minister. It gives a sense of accomplishment. It moves you up the ranks. Personally to the family, it certifies your calling, gives you access. Those are some of the answers. This is all of the affective side. This is some of the reasons why they became credentialed. The sense of being called, when I explained their journey, some of them started early in their life. Some changed their plans because of their calling. At a youth rally, some heard the word right there. At a youth rally, they heard the preaching and they heard God calling them. Some fall to some kind of shepherding. This is all affective. This is all the affective side of these young people. Feeling motivated, the affective side. Someone motivating, the pastors, one said. Parents, the other said. Church leaders all needed a little encouragement. So this is, you add the cognitive side, the information, and then you add the feeling, the affective side. So on the affective side, I also wanted to see what they thought about the detractors. Why are some of your friends, some of your peers, why do you think that they're not pursuing to become credential ministers, etc.? What's the need for a credential? This is, you know, one young lady and one young guy. Some are searching for more than the regular standards, because leadership is not truly defined. Others say ignorance of the bigger picture, withdrawal from organizations and choosing independence, frustration with the church. They feel they are always negotiating. This was very interesting. One young person told me, Pastor, if we go to an Anglo church, then we lose our Latino flavor. He described it with like el sabor Latino, flavor of having a Latino context. If we go back to our Latino churches, we feel that we don't have our place. So he said, every time we feel that we're always negotiating something, we're always losing something. So that was one of his answers. I thought it was very interesting, that conversation. So those were the detractors. The third component of attitude, which is behavior, we saw cognitive, affective, and behavior. The behavioral component refers to past behavior or experiences regarding an attitude, collaboration, mentorship, opportunities, collaboration. Young Latino desire to be involved in things that are meaningful. So young Latino wants to be influencers on social media. Collaboration must be meaningful for young Latinos. Young Latinos want to make genuine contribution. These are all answers. But not to serve as a model to other peers, a desire to get back. So this is the collaboration aspect of the behavior. Mentorship, someone who can walk side by side of them in ministry. They all told me that they miss a mentorship program. And of course, here in our district, we have Mark Vega, who has Ignite discipleship program, but they talked about why can't districts partner with mentorship programs. This is some of the answers they gave. The district do not give us He said, one of them said, I remember well this interview, don't give us traditions, translate them for us, or give us answers that speak our language. Desiring to work along their pastors, many of them, and not having access to the pastor. Being open to adults in mentoring. I desire to be molded and told and taught, said YL17M. And in this last one, opportunities, young Latinos received that contributed to their decision. They allow me to help and lead the youth. Some of them said, I was involved with my parents in ministry. And one said, we want our voices to be heard. We want our voices to be heard. So tentative conclusions. Remember this, I still have a couple of, you know, years to bring this into a conclusion, because I still have more interviews. But at least for now, these are some of the things that I'm facing. I believe there are attitudes and behaviors that affect our and influence young Latinos in their decisions to become credentialed ministers with FMD. They exist, and somehow we're going to have to deal with these attitudes. The attitudes, meaning those three components. There's something about credentialing or ordination process that some of our young Latinos don't understand, or they're not clear, or they have bad experiences about them or feelings about them. Number two, there's a generational shift young Latinos are experiencing as they build their future, looking at everything different from the older generation. So I noticed that there is a shift. Third, I included this these people, as Howie and Strauss described. They wrote a great, I mean, it's a big manual on millennials. And it's like these two guys are like the guru when it talk when you want to study millennials and where are they going to the future. It's very interesting. And Howie and Strauss describe this generation is not looking to destroy all institutions that don't work, instead to build new ones that do work. And I thought that was an interesting quote, because we sometimes feel that, but that what they want, that the young Latinos or new generation, what they want to do is destroy. No, Howie and Strauss said they don't want to destroy the old. They want to construct new ones that work. And the fourth one, the majority of our young Latinos of FMD have not demonstrated an interest in credentialing process yet. This reduced number, the 60 that we have, of those who have credentials are in the pursuit of helping build a new FMD. So Dennis, this is at least my partial, we have no conclusions. I can't make any kind of statements, you know, yet. But this is what I'm doing right now.
Brother Nino, thank you so very much. Very insightful, very informative. And I think we should allow a couple of questions here, because we're not going to do questions yet, because John Davidson is in the room now.
Continuing we'll have you move through this. The conversation.
And John Davidson, who many of you know, works with TMN, but you also don't know that he is actually the director for higher education.
Yeah, the Alliance for Assemblies of God Higher Education.
Okay, so John is working with all of our colleges and universities in the Assemblies of God. So he is in touch with our educators and actually with young people. This is also a subject very dear to his heart. So we are honored that he's with us, and he's actually going to take the next 30 minutes and continue the conversation about Next Gen.
Well, thank you so much, Ellie and Dennis, for inviting me to be here. And it's so good to see all of you virtually on the screen. Some of you I know and some of you I don't. Pastor Nino, you were talking about starting at a later age, getting your PhD. I applaud you for that. I started at a pretty young age getting mine. And I think we could probably agree that no matter when you start, it's a major feat to get a degree like that. And so I applaud you for getting yours. And so I actually want to talk a little bit about education and the role of higher ed in discipling students. And I want you to think, as I'm talking, not so much about higher education as like specifically a college, but more like the years, the higher education years of a person's life, which, you know, traditionally is going to be like the ages of 18 to 23 years old. So I'm kind of talking about those young adult years of a person's life and how important those are. So, you know, there have been a lot of statistics over the years that have talked about the importance of reaching young people for Christ. And I think as a movement, we have done a really good job over the years of reaching young people for Christ through our kids' ministries, through our youth ministries, and we've done a great job of discipleship. But I believe we can always do better. We can do better in our kids' ministries and youth ministries, and we can do better in our young adult ministries as well. You know, our movement's 106 years old now. And we've been doing discipleship really well for a long time. I'm grateful to be a part of a movement like that with a history of discipleship, strong discipleship. But it does seem like some of the stats that I'm going to show you here in just a moment will show you that we're having some difficulties in a specific part of our discipleship, notably the part when students go to college. So most of us understand how important it is to keep good connection with college-age students, young adults, because there have been all kinds of stats over the years that show that, you know, when students leave our youth groups, that they kind of have a very good chance of falling out of touch with the church and kind of leaving their relationship with Christ behind. And that's why I think every single one of us ought to be really interested in those higher education years of a student's life, because it makes a huge impact on their long-term discipleship. So that's what we're going to talk about today. And I think the more engaged we can be as church leaders in these young adult seasons of a person's life, the more it will contribute to them becoming what I call durable disciples, or disciples that last, you know, people that have an enduring discipleship relationship with the Lord, people who have an enduring faith. So what you see on the screen in front of you is what demographers call the life cycle effect. And this is a well-established trend in how people at different ages of their life relate to religion. And this is not just Christianity, but religion in general, or more specifically, religious services in general. So whether they're Christian or Islam or Jewish, pretty much everybody follows this life cycle. So when you're young, you see on the left-hand side, when you're under 18, your parents make you go to church. So your engagement is pretty high. But when you enter into young adulthood, that next section, engagement drops significantly. And it drops significantly for Jewish kids. It drops for Christian kids. It drops for Mormon kids. It drops for pretty much everybody. And then you see the next section over, when you get married, you entered into that stage of life that kind of is the general age of people starting to get married and have kids. Their engagement goes back up with church services. But from there on, people start to make drastic decisions about their faith. And what you kind of see this split. The blue line continues to go up. Those are people who make the decision that they really do like going to church. They want a relationship with the Lord. They want to be a disciple. And then you see this red line going down, because there's this split in people, how people relate to their faith. So you have about half the population that draws closer to the Lord and about half the population that ends up drifting away from their faith. And so that's kind of the life cycle that I want to talk to you about today. And how can we engage people in that second column, the young adult column, and keep their engagement high? So we know that this slump in young adult engagement with Christianity and young adult engagement with the church is low. That's normal. So I think when we see that, that should help to remind us not to panic. If we see young people who go off to college and maybe they start not attending church faithfully every Sunday or something like that. So we shouldn't panic. But it should encourage us to find ways to engage young people with the church and engage young people with Scripture. Amen. So here's another graph. This graph shows the top line is people's religion when they're 16 years old. The bottom line is those same people reporting their religion as an adult. So this is called an alluvial graph. It shows movement from one group to another. So you see that people who were evangelical when they were 16 on the top, that red box, the vast majority of them, when they become an adult, guess what? They're still evangelical. Now, they may, you know, their level of church attendance may change, but they're still evangelical. Evangelicals lose very few people. We're fortunate. We lose very, very few people over time. If you start out as an evangelical, you're raised in an evangelical home, chances are as an adult, you're going to continue to be evangelical. But you'll notice the ones that we do lose, we lose to the no religion category. So it's interesting. If you're going to stop being an evangelical, you stop everything. Nobody moves from evangelical to mainline Christian or evangelical to Catholic. It just doesn't happen. I mean, sure, it may happen to one or two people, but it's not even enough to show up on the graph. If you're going to stop being evangelical, you just drop religion completely. And the stats tell us that the time when that happens for that group of people is during those young adult years. That's when they stop being an evangelical. So I'm thankful that that evangelicals don't lose very many people overall, but I think we would all agree that we don't want to lose anybody.
Amen.
We don't want to lose anybody from the faith, especially when they're going through those young adult years. And another thing that the stats tell us, if you'll go to that next slide, here's an interesting stat that I think we should be concerned with as Pentecostals. While attending private or public secular colleges, students coming from more conservative religious backgrounds leave their faith at a higher rate than students from less conservative denominations. So I know you know this, but in terms of conservative denominations, the Assemblies of God is one of the most conservative. I mean, we're all the way at the, I was going to say the right side. I guess we are the right side. We're pretty much very, very conservative. What the statistics tell us, though, is that a kid that grows up in an Assemblies of God church and leaves our home and our churches and goes to a public university, a secular university, there's actually a really high chance that that student's going to fall away from their faith. And that's scary. I hate that.
Amen.
It just is true according to statistics, though. And there may be a lot of reasons why. I think one of the biggest reasons is because this student grows up in a kind of a sheltered life. Yeah, kind of a conservative bubble, if you will. And then all of a sudden they go to the secular school and it's just kind of blows their minds because it's all of a sudden they've got total freedom. There's very few conservative people there. Everybody's liberal. They're encouraged to explore everything that's never been available to them before. They're encouraged to go past the boundaries in pretty much every area of their life. And so they end up being sucked in by that kind of lifestyle. And so basically what I'm trying to tell you is this: as Pentecostals, we actually stand a very good chance of keeping our kids in the Pentecostal faith unless we send them to a secular college. That's what the stats tell us. And so this isn't meant to just be a commercial for Christian colleges or for AG colleges, but I think it's important for us to really examine this period of a person's life and say, how can we engage young people who are in that 18 to 25 year space and keep them engaged in the faith? One of those ways is that if they engage in Christian higher education,
yes,
whether that's one of our Assemblies of God schools or a local Christian university to wherever they live, wherever that might be, if they engage other Christians and believers in an education and process of study during those years of their life, they're more likely to stay in the faith. So here's where I want to get down to the really practical side. And that is this: what can pastors do to help keep our kids in the faith? The first thing is that pastors can help disciple students and parents through the process of their education years, especially their higher education years. So I'm always encouraging pastors to be a part of the process where kids in your church are choosing where to go to college.
Amen.
And some pastors say, well, that's none of my business. That's for the parents to decide. That's for the kids to decide. What I would say is it's so important. Those years are so critical that as a pastor, if you care about that young person's spiritual life, you need to be involved in the process. You need to yep, insert yourself in the process,
yep,
even if you're not invited. So yep, statistics tell us yep, that there is one person more than any other person that influences where a young person will go to college. And that person is their mama.
Mama. Mm-hmm.
And mm-hmm, guess what? There's one person that a Christian mama listens to more than
pastor,
anybody, and that's her pastor.
Amen.
So as a pastor, if you can influence mama and tell her how important it is for her kid to be engaging in a Christian education process, there's a really good chance that her kids will end up going that direction. So I think pastors encouraging and equipping people in their church when it comes to the education process is really important. Second thing is this, that churches and pastors and leaders should educate themselves about the importance of higher education. If we understood what was happening during these 18 to 25 year old years, if we understood what was happening in there, we would be more engaged and pay more attention to it. So number one, those are formative years. All the statistics tell us that after age 13, the people who have the greatest influence in your life are no longer your parents, they're your friends. It's the people that you're around that are outside of your family. So when a student goes to college, they are all of a sudden surrounded by non-family members who become very good friends of theirs, and those friends have a tremendous impact on their life. So what I'm saying is, who you are friends with between the ages of 18 and 25 really matters. Those people influence the direction of your future life. And so we have to ask ourselves the question, what kinds of places have the kinds of friends that I want my kids to be around? Could my friends find good Christian friends on a secular college campus? Yes, they could, maybe. There's a potential that they could. But I think they're more likely to find a lot of good Christian friends on a Christian college campus. That's why this becomes so important in a young person's discipleship. And these years are so formative that, you know, it's during the college years, these 18 to 25 year old season of a person's life, that they're making a decision about what they're going to do with their life, what their career is going to be, who they're going to marry, what job they're going to have, where they want to live eventually. So many of the adult habits that they create are created during that 18 to 25 a year old season. So it makes this a really formative time of their life. And if that student is in a setting where they're not engaging spiritually with a body of believers and with other Christian friends during that time, you can be sure the habits that they're creating during those years will not line up with what you and I would say are Christian norms and values. So we got to make sure that young people between the ages of 18 and 25 are really engaging with other Christian believers. Another thing is, it's a time of tremendous spiritual formation in a person's life. I mean, it's a lot of those, the 18 to 25 year range are times when we first start hearing from the Lord a lot of times, and we start hearing from God about what he wants us to do with our lives. And I just know for me, it was during those years that, it was during those years that I was baptized in the Holy Spirit. I grew up in an AG minister's home, and I sought the baptism of the Holy Spirit all the time when I was young, from the time I was just a little child all the way up through my middle school and high school years. It wasn't until I was a student at Evangel University that I was baptized in the Holy Spirit in a chapel service. And so when you're at a Christian university that values spiritual formation, God can use that in tremendous ways in a person's life. And of course, the opposite of true is true if you're in a place that devalues, and most of our secular universities don't just not value spiritual formation, they devalue spiritual formation. So it actually is a liability there, and they stay away from it. So it's really, really important a time in a person's life. Another thing I would say about it is that pastors have to help families prepare for higher education. Again, if we care about this season of people's lives, we have to help them think ahead about higher education. Now, let's get down to brass tacks and talk about the reality of Christian higher education. It's expensive. I wish I could say it was cheaper than secular education, but it's just not. Some of us sitting around the table, maybe most of us, have gone to Christian higher education or sent our kids to Christian higher education. It's expensive, and some of you are in the same boat. You have sent your kids to a Christian college, maybe one of our AG schools, and you can testify to the fact that it is expensive. I wish there was something that I could do to fix that problem. There's not. I can't fix it. I don't have a big closet with a big stash of money that I can give you. And I know that you don't have a big closet with a stash of money that you can give to people in your churches and districts and ministries to help them with college. But what we can do is, as pastors and leaders, we can help people prepare. We can be talking to parents and even to students about this from early on, way before they're ready to go to college, and to say, listen, in 10 years, your kid, your son, your daughter is going to be ready to go to school. You need to be saving now. You need to be preparing now. You need to be thinking now about how you're going to equip them to be discipled when they go to college. I know that for most people, Christian colleges and universities seem, well, quite frankly, the finances just seem out of touch. It seems like it's just so far out there that we can't even save up enough money for it. And I understand that. But it's one of the reasons that I think as pastors and leaders, we can equip people to be ready by educating them. Not only tell them to start saving now, but tell them, help them understand what the real cost of college is. You know, a lot of times, a Christian young person, they will look on the website of a Christian college, and because it's a private school, they accept sticker shock. There's like, oh my goodness, $37,000 a year or whatever it is, you know, and they're like, there's no way I can afford that. And that's probably true. There is no way they can afford that. But guess what? Nobody pays $37,000 a year. Very few people do. And the chances are the person in your church, that young person, if they wanted to go to that school, they wouldn't have to pay $37,000 a year. They could apply for scholarships and grants, and they could get financial aid, and the school would help them. And so by the time they actually get to school, the price is way, way lower. But some people, some students and parents, they never investigate it enough to actually find that out. So one of the things we can do as leaders is we can help them to know those kinds of things. Hey, you know that price that's on the college website? You don't have to pay that. Let me help you. Let me be on the phone with you when you call the college and talk to the financial aid counselor. And, you know, I think sometimes as pastors and leaders, we trust that everybody else will do that, and we ought to get involved in that process. If we have a student that's wanting to attend a Christian college, because again, it's such an important part of their life. We should do whatever we can to help make it happen for them. Fourth thing is this, that we should design discipleship pathways for college students. Remember, we're not just talking about students going to college. We're talking about students who are even in our churches, who are in this college age, this young adult age. We need to have special things for them in our discipleship pathways. Amen. A lot of the reasons why young adults disengage during their 18 to 25 year old years is because oftentimes the church doesn't have anything for them. So that student now is out of youth group because they're 18 or 19. So they've kind of graduated out of the youth ministry, but they don't fully feel like an adult. You know, they're not married, they don't have kids, they're not living on their own necessarily. So it's like they don't fit anywhere. They don't fit with the kids, they don't fit with the youth, and they don't fit with the adults either. And so a lot of times they disengage, and they'll find places outside the church where they fit in other friend groups. And so I'm just encouraging you and encouraging churches all over the country to create discipleship pathways specifically for college students. And I think when you're thinking about discipleship pathways for college students, think in terms of flexible time commitments, but high spiritual commitments. So call students to make spiritual commitments. Don't necessarily require a lot of time for them. Don't ask them to serve 20 hours a week because you know they want to be going to school, they want to have a social life, they want to do all these other things. And so but make sure that that's a part of your planning when you're planning out how people are discipled in your church. What are we doing for college students? Are we doing things that are fun? Are we giving them a place where there's a lot of grace, where they can ask a lot of questions because they're in a season where they're asking a lot of questions about life? Okay, last thing is this. I would really encourage churches to support and partner with Chi Alpha.
Amen.
So I've talked so much about the importance of sending our kids to Christian universities, and I do believe that ought to be a priority because I think that's where students have the best shot at maintaining a high relationship with the Lord, and the statistics tell us that. But I will say this, we all know that a lot of times a student will go to maybe a local community college, or they'll go to a local state college, a public school, either because it's cheaper, or because that's where their friends are going, or because that school has the major and the courses of study that that student wants. And I think that's fine. But as a pastor, we ought to prioritize their spiritual lives, which means if that student in my church says, hey, I'm going to go to whatever, here in town, it would be like Missouri State University. If they say, I'm going to go to Missouri State University, I would say, man, that, I think that's fine. I think that's great. You do that. But you know what? Let me connect you with the Chi Alpha program there. Let me connect you with the person that leads Chi Alpha. And I want to help you get involved in a spiritual community there where you can grow and where you can be discipled by people who have a high commitment to your spiritual formation. So I want to tell you this real quick. Our colleges and universities, Assemblies of God, are second to none. I think they're awesome.
Yep.
Your students go there, they're going to be safe. They're gonna have a way higher chance of maintaining their commitment with the Lord. And if your students go to some place where they can get plugged into a Chi Alpha, they're also going to have a really high chance of staying committed to the Lord, because Chi Alpha is run by top shelf leaders.
Yes.
Nationally and locally here at the national office and all in our districts around the country.
Yes.
And so all I'm doing today is I'm just wanting to reinforce to you that though we have for a long time done a great job discipling kids and youth up to the age of 18, we cannot stop at 18. If you don't leave with anything else from today, I want to encourage you to make it your goal to disciple young people in your church very strategically and intentionally all the way through age 25. So 18 is not the finish line. Let's call it, if we're going to make a finish line, let's make it 25. Every statistic I can find says that if we can disciple kids strong and have so that they'll have a strong relationship with the Lord through age 25, chances are they will finish out the rest of their life loving Jesus and serving him. And raising their kids to do that as well. So that's my encouragement to you today.
Amen. Awesome job. Thank you so much. And I think it's pretty apparent that this is something you wholeheartedly have committed your life to. We've chatted from my onset of visiting the national, coming onto the national office and sitting, visiting with you in your office. And that commitment to discipleship that doesn't end at 18, but says, you know, we need to stay with our kids and we need to pastor them through the college years. Just because they're not in your church physically, you need to stay in touch with them and let them know that we care and that they're still important to what we're doing.